I traveled to Leh Ladakh last year on my bike. It was horrible, but it was totally worth it. I want to travel to the northeast on the bike again. I know it's going to be really, really bad, but I want to explore it. That's how India is. That's how amazing our tourism potential is. But we've not been utilizing it for a very long time. The infrastructure, the kind of policy support that is required for infrastructure for tourism has not yet developed. And that is what we are going to discuss today. The next driver that Niti Aayog talks about is tourism and hospitality industry in India. Truly, Niti Aayog has put a very nice picture on how important travel, tourism and hospitality is for India. So I have divided the discussion that we are going to have into two parts. Number one, we'll be talking about why is tourism so important. I will give you some small yet important facts, but largely we'll be talking about the important areas. And then we'll talk about the problems that we are facing. And based on those problems only, I have charted out certain solutions. So these are the solutions that I have mentioned here. Okay, so we have why is tourism important, what are the problems that India is facing, and what are the solutions that we need in order to develop our tourism and travel industry. Okay, so let's start with the first part, which is the why part, as to why is it that travel, tourism, hospitality industry in India is so important for us. Okay, don't worry about the facts. For RBI examination, whatever facts are important, I'm going to cover all those facts towards the end, once we have understood and internalized what exactly tourism and travel industry is and why is it so important for us. Okay, so number one important factor is again twofold. Here I have written foreign exchange reserves to 22.92 billion US dollars. This is the data for 2017-18. And this here is the foreign exchange earnings that India has made in the year 2017-18 through travel and tourism of foreign tourists coming into India. The other part is for which data is very less, and it says that the FDI inflow into India for travel and tourism is only 0.9 billion US dollars. So the government wants, and or Niti Aayog wants, that the government should of course be focusing on this because it is very important. We are getting a lot of dollars, but at the same time the FDI potential in travel and tourism is very large, and we have not been able to explore that just because we have not developed the travel and tourism industry to the level we can, because there is so much diversity. You travel from the north to the south, you will feel that you are totally in a different country. Okay, but therefore the FDI potential is very large. So the first important factor of why travel and tourism industry is so important for us is, number one, we are already getting a lot of foreign exchange earnings, which is 22.92 billion US dollars in the year 2017-18, and number two, the FDI potential is still unexplored. Okay, the second important factor is economic growth. Now whatever we are going to discuss today is going to have an impact on economic growth. The entire travel tourism industry has a positive impact on economic growth. Number one, how? Number one, it creates employment. Let's say you go to Mussoorie tomorrow because summers are coming up, and you spend about 5,000 per person. Four of you decide to go together. 20,000, that is something that you've spent. Where is that money going? That money is gone into shops where you shopped, where you bought something for your family, bought something for your friends, you spent money on eating, you spent money on staying in Mussoorie. So all that money is contributing towards economic growth because money is exchanging hands. Okay, so that is how travel and tourism is a big industry when it comes to economic growth potential or economic growth enhancement in the economy. For example, a lot of people come to Delhi every year. Now all those shops, all those restaurants, all those cafes which are earning a lot more than they would be earning, that they would have earned if there was no travel and tourism in the in that particular state or in the capital of India, you can only imagine how much more is everybody getting to earn and how much more is money exchanging hands. So all that is resulting into economic growth because there is more demand. That means there is more production of goods and services. That means more GDP, more economic growth. The third and the one of the most important for me is the contribution to employment. as per Niti Aayog's report for 2016, 40.3 million people were employed directly or indirectly in the travel and tourism industry. That is almost 9.3% of the entire employment which is generated every year. So almost 10%, almost 1/10 of the employment that we are generating is coming through travel and tourism. So in the services sector, the contribution is almost 60%. Out of that, almost 10% is coming from travel tourism. That is a very big number. That is a huge number. And we can increase it further. You can only imagine what is the potential here. We have not worked upon creating an organized employment when it comes to travel and tourism. So if you organize the entire thing, you can only imagine that this can actually jump to directly to almost 20%. So that is the potential of travel tourism industry in India. The next one is soft power. You must have heard a lot about India's soft power, and the major soft power that India has is yoga. Okay, yoga is one of the main soft powers that India has been using for quite some time now. In fact, there's a very interesting story here. I was sitting in an interview some time back. I was a part of the interview. I mean, I was there for the interview. And the interviewer asked me, what is glocalization? They asked me, what is glocalization? So I explained to them the entire concept of glocalization. They asked me for an example as to how India is involved in glocalization. And I thought a lot about it for almost a minute, and I gave them the most obvious example of McDonald's. Okay, but the moment I stepped out of the interview room, I realized that I could have mentioned yoga. Yoga is how Indian soft power is being adopted by the US and transformed by the US or changed by the US to create different kinds of yoga, and that is also a form of globalization. Not with respect to India. India is not localizing something global, but US is localizing something global with respect to India. So that is the importance of soft power that we have. And the most obvious and the most important example here is yoga. So globalization or yoga or the soft power that we have is not only going to contribute towards more earnings or more international presence, it also results in more attraction to tourists. Okay, so that's why it becomes very important. So that is another reason why we need to promote tourism and travel in the country. Now there are two important more reasons that I have not mentioned here. Let me mention them somewhere here. Number one is wildlife. If there is no tourism, then there will be lesser protection of wildlife, which is already under threat in India. A lot of people come to national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, and they give a lot of money. They pay hefty sums of money, especially foreign tourists. And that is how wildlife protection moves forward. So that is one contribution. And number two, and very important, is innovation. Okay, a lot of people who come to India come with their own cultures, come with their own thoughts, and that results in generation of ideas. Similarly, we also go out of the country, we travel to other parts of the world, and we borrow a lot of different ideas. For example, recently I was watching a video on Eco India, and that particular episode was about a couple in Mumbai which has adopted the technology from Israel, which the technology is basically creation or generation of plants or farming in a closed setting. So that technology has been adopted from Israel by that couple, and the purpose is to generate food and food products in a closed environment, in a closed setting. Just think about it, how amazing that technology would be. And that was a result, direct result of them traveling to Israel and then looking after that particular technology, and they immediately thought, why not bring it to India? They quit their jobs and started working on it. So that is the why part. A total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 points in the why part. I hope you have understood why travel, tourism and hospitality industry is so important for India. But what are the problems that we are facing? What exactly are we not doing right, and what are the areas in which we need to focus in order to ensure that the travel tourism industry in India flourishes? Number one, the entry and exit norms when it comes to e-visa or e-medical visas is very strict. Herein, the Niti Aayog says that we need to promote number one MICE, which stands for meetings, incentives, conferences and exhibitions. So a lot of tourism towards India happens in the form of MICE also. A lot of people come for meetings, a lot of people come for exhibitions, different kinds of activities are involved, which are completely corporate in nature, which are completely what? Corporate in nature. So promotion of these kind of activities in India, corporate activities in India, can only happen if the e-visa norms are more favorable when it comes to MICE. The same goes for e-medical. You must be aware about it. If you are not, let me tell you, India is very popular for medical tourism also, because medical checkups here, medical health programs here are comparatively cheaper, much cheaper and of a much higher quality when it comes to comparison with the advanced level countries. Now what happens if you're traveling on a medical visa, then there are limitations to the number of times one person can travel every year, which is 3 presently, and number of people who can accompany a sick person, which is 2. So Niti Aayog says that we need to increase this so that e-medical tourism also increases in the country through better e-medical visas. I hope this is clear. This is completely policy oriented change that we need to make. The second is train or flight, which is basically traveling inside the country. I will also give you a very beautiful example here. The government's initiative or the solution that Niti Aayog has given is that we need to work on policies similar to Udaan. So Udaan was for flights, for air routes. Similarly, we need to come out with similar policies for train as well as for roads. Now there's a very important example here that I thought I must share with you. I was traveling to, some place in South India last year, and I met a person from Denmark, and she had been, she could not move out of that particular small city in the southern part of the country just because she could not get a train ticket. Why she could not get a train ticket? Because she, being a foreigner, did not have the right or did not have any possible method of creating her own account on IRCTC and booking a ticket. So she could not book a ticket on her own, which is a torture on her, because she wanted to travel as per her convenience, but she did not have the flexibility of booking a ticket on her own. She had to go all the way to a bookie or an intermediary and get the tickets booked. And she could not find that because everything was on leave. Everybody was on leave, there was festival mood going on, so she was finding it difficult to book a train ticket. She was stranded in that particular small town for almost 7 to 8 days just because of this problem. So this is also directly connected with the comfort level that we offer to our foreign tourists. Okay, and this, any discomfort on this point can actually drive away tourists and drive away people connected to those tourists. Okay, so you need to work upon infrastructure development and schemes similar to Udaan if you want to provide a better train of flight experience to the foreign tourist and also to the domestic tourist. The third is circuits. We need to create dedicated circuits in order to ensure that people are able to travel more smoothly. If they come to India, they don't know anything much about the country, they just want to travel to the popular places, they should be able to do that. Okay, there are two schemes which have already been launched. If you've not read about them, read about them. They're very important for the upcoming exam. Swadesh Darshan and Prashad, both of them are for circuits only, different kinds of schemes. And I have covered both these schemes in the government scheme section. Okay, so I will not be talking about specifics of these schemes here, but we need to develop circuits. Similarly, we have started creating river cruises, and the government has now created a plan or a target of having at least 5 dedicated river cruises for foreign and domestic tourists in India. So similar kind of policy changes, similar kind of targets need to be set up. Comfort, I have already explained through that example, and then we have skills, which is very important for creating this employment here. So if you want to create meaningful employment, you need to skill those people. You must have seen the ad of Aamir Khan where he talks about how India can be incredible. The tagline of the government of India is Incredible India. But how can you be incredible? Only if your people are skilled enough, only if your people are professional enough to take care of the foreigners when they arrive in the country. So there's a big need to create better skilling opportunities, to provide better skilling opportunities if you want employment to increase in the travel and tourism sector. Okay, so this was all about the travel and tourism understanding part. Now let's move to the factual part, where I am going to talk about certain small facts which are specifically important for the upcoming RBI exam. First of all, let's talk about the contribution of travel and tourism in the year 2016, the data which has been given by Niti Aayog. So you can see here 4 points. The first one is foreign tourist arrivals, which is 8.8 million. Now, foreign tourist arrivals were 8.8 million in the year 2016, but the target is to increase it to almost 12 million in the next 2 to 3 years. Okay, that is the target that Niti Aayog has given. Domestic tourist visits was 1613 million in the year 2016, and the target is to increase it to 3200 million. So first of all, the numbers of 2016: foreign tourist arrivals 8.8, domestic tourist visits 1613 million. Employment, I've already mentioned 40.3 million, and foreign exchange earnings also I've already mentioned 22.92 billion US dollars. Now, what are the targets for the next 4 to 5 years? Number one, increase the global international tourist arrivals from 1.18% to 3%. Number two, number of foreign tourist arrivals from 8.8 to 12 million, not very difficult to remember, and number of domestic tourist visits from 1612 or almost 1614 million to 3200 million visits in within the country. Okay, that is number one fact. Second one is India has moved up from 52nd to 40th rank in the World Economic Forum's Travel and Tourism Competitiveness Index in the year 2017. That's the data given by Niti Aayog, not very difficult to remember. But in fact, even that number, that rank 40th, is very less, because we have a lot of potential in the country. Okay, so these are the two some important facts that you needed to remember. Now, when we were talking about entry and exit, then the Niti Aayog says that the e-visa limits should be increased to 10 years, which is also the policy followed by US. If you get a visa, you get a visa for almost 8 to 10 years, which is a tourist visa. That should be the policy of India as well. Okay, number one. Second is for infrastructure, it says that any infrastructure project, any project of travel and tourism whose value is more than 1 crore should be automatically granted the tag of infrastructure project, so that it's better, it's easier for that particular project to get funds, and it's they also get funds on an easier basis, on an easier loans, which are wherein the interest rates are low, the gestation period is higher. So all those advantages automatically arise. Okay, and then there's the last target of creating, number one that I mentioned, 5 river cruises or 5 beach destinations. That is the exact term. 100 smart tourist destination sites. So smart tourist destination sites 100 and 5 beach destinations. So these are all the targets or all the facts that have been given by Niti Aayog. I hope these facts are understood now and you can remember them better now that we have discussed it. If you like this video, do not forget to subscribe to the channel, and do not forget to press the bell icon also, because that will ensure that whenever I come out with such amazing videos, you get a notification automatically. Okay, all the very best for your examination. Take care.